not me. If someone came and said, what is this I hear about you? To dwell on the ground of your stewardship. Because you can no longer be my steward. The steward said to himself, what shall I do now that my master is taking the position of steward away from me? I'm not strong enough to keep, and I'm ashamed to bear. I know what I shall do, so that when I'm removed from the stewardship, they may welcome me into their homes. He called in his master's debtors one by one. In the first one he said, how much do you owe my master? He replied, 100 measures of olive oil. He said to him, here is your promissory note. Sit down and quickly write 150. Then to another, the steward said, and you, how much do you owe? He replied, 100 talents of wheat. The steward said to him, here is your promissory note, write 180. And the master commended that dishonored steward for acting prudently. For the children of this world are more prudent in dealing with their own generation than other children of life. I tell you, make friends for yourself with this one as well, so that when it falls, when it fails, you will be welcomed into eternal dwellings. The person who is trustworthy in very small matters is also trustworthy in great ones. And the person who is dishonest in very small matters is also dishonest in great ones. If therefore you are not trustworthy with dishonest wealth, who will trust you with true wealth? If you are not trustworthy with what belongs to another, who will give you what is yours? No servant can serve the masters. You are to hate one or love the other. Or to be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and mammon. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
The lessons to be drawn from this parable is that the followers of Jesus must also act prudently in regard to their own future prospects. In this gospel, it should be noted that the steward, although he lacks a management skill, he was probably not as unjust as it seems. In all likelihood, he was simply subtracting his own substantial commission from the debt owed to his master. Now, the saying that follows the parable focus on what he said and make it clear what Jesus has in mind is the attitude that his followers must adopt. How do we manage our earthly possession? What is our attitude towards what we have? Our money, your bank account, your resources, your house, and also your talents, the gifts you have, your personal talents. If we allow all these things, human talents, money and wealth, to monopolize our time and effort, Jose Maria Escriva says, it's more dangerous to be prosperous than to be poor. The danger to the soul. People who are extremely wealthy, extremely talented, they become so engrossed in managing what they have. They are frequently distracted from the real purpose of human life. In this situation, they may very well be so distracted, so occupied, that they will discover that it's too late, that they have wasted the only ultimately significant opportunity in their lives. Relationship with one another and relationship with God. The same situation, the lesson can be for those people who are extremely talented or extremely good looking. So much so that's all they have. And they never felt the need to develop a mature or pleasing personality. They are talented, they are rich, but they can be very, very rude and obnoxious. You see, some people have money, but no class. They don't know how to behave because they have everything, all that they need in life. They don't care. And many people who have very well to do, they don't believe in God. They don't think God is real. Because they have everything they want. That is why Jesus says, blessed are the poor. They go see God. Blessed are those who mourn. Blessed are the pure in heart. The blessed are the poor. They are the one. The poor in spirit and poor in material government. Well, that's what we mean by the curse of great talents. People who are extremely low and low in terms of material things or gifts, sometimes they live very, very miserable life. They see sometimes in newspaper movie stars and experts at the height of their fame, they commit suicide. They couldn't take the pressure. The lives are being, it's involved in that. Now, this wisdom of him is also fulfilled in the new parable of the rich man and Lazarus. And this is so interesting. The rich man and Lazarus. First of all, the rich man, he has no name. We don't know who is he. He may be any of us. And Lazarus, of course, is a poor fellow. Now, the rich man is a new apostle. There was no indication that he got the money dishonestly. In fact, he earned the money, he belongs to him. But why did he end up in hell? He ended up in hell because he is so preoccupied in managing his wealth that he does not, or he did not know this, that the poor man is counting on his doorstep. That is his problem. He has no concern about other people. He's just self-absorbed. Luke lives in the city in Antioch, where he can see the dangers of wealth, flourishing city, and more importantly, the gap between the very rich and the very poor. It was a prosperous city, where the extreme of wealth and poverty was clearly evident. And therefore, Luke warns us that possession can have, in a sense, a drugging effect on their own. We, instead of we own them, they own us. We become too attached to them. They own us, we don't own them. We become a slave to these things, the things that we have. This is the same story about the rich farmer. In Luke chapter 12, the rich farmer was worried about building bigger barns to store up his bountiful harvest. But God called him suddenly, and that night everything is gone. He had preoccupation or obsession with riches that reduce one's need to place our awareness of others. We have become self-absorbed and we know are not sensitive to the needs of others and the needs of the people who need most. They are not in our priority, or we think of ourselves. And this is the danger of wealth. When the gospel says that we must choose between God and heaven, it asks us to declare where we finally put our trust. Where is our real security? Wealth and talents that serve God's purpose, but they must never replace God.